Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for tuning in. My name is Alex Parker. I am a freelance character animator and motion designer from Dallas, Texas. I so wish that I could be talking with all of y'all in person today, but nevertheless, I am so excited to be here. Thank you so much to Maxon and to Matthias for getting all this together. And to get this show on the road, I'm going to go ahead and screen my reel and then we can get this show started. So thank y'all so much. Let's roll the reel.
Mood like that. Look in here, can you mood like that? Huh? Mood like that. Look in here, can you mood like that?
It keeps me up. Anxiety. Even when I'm yawning. Machine gun. I keep running over. I can't get no sleep. My love is pouring. From your machine gun.
Alrighty, so that's my reel, that's my work. I hope you enjoyed it. Before we get too knee-deep in this presentation, I'm going to go ahead and give you a bit of an overview of what this presentation will entail. So first, we're going to get into a little background check about yours truly. I'll give you a little breakdown of my history, the work that I've done, where I come from, and then we'll hop into the actual presentation where we're going to start with defining and designing your characters, bringing a lot of character to your work. And we'll do that through breaking down two shorts that I've worked on. One is a personal project. We'll dive into that character design a little bit, and then we're going to use what we learned there to hop into the character design for the Cinnamon Toast Crunch short that you saw in my reel. And then for the rest of the presentation, we're going to stick with that Cinnamon Toast Crunch short. That'll be the meat of our presentation. And from there, we're going to break down some of the behind the scenes animation tips and tricks that we used in Cinema 4D to bring that Cinnamon Toast Crunch short to life. So let's hop into me. My name is, again, Alex Parker. I'm a freelance character animator and motion designer based in Dallas, Texas. And once I decided that I, in fact, did not want to be an orthodontist, I switched gears entirely, and I went to Texas A&M University to study animation there under the Bachelor of Science Visualization program. I spent every day and every night in this building, which I love so much. If there's a couch in this building, I've slept on it. Didn't do a ton of sleeping in college, but if I did, it was in a couch in this building. And it was while I was at Texas A&M that I branched off for a semester and did an internship with the Disney College program. Absolutely loved my time there, and that made it super clear that I did not want to be an orthodontist, but I instead wanted to make really bright colored cartoons for the rest of my life. So after graduating Texas A&M, whoop, I went on to Bournemouth University, which is actually in England, and it's there that I got my Master of Arts in 3D Computer Animation. And I absolutely loved my time here as well. It was an absolute blast. And both of these programs actually were Maya-based programs. They were both Maya-based and generalist programs, which at the time, I kind of had a hard time figuring out what the desired end result of these programs were, because I thought I really wanted to animate for film, but I was having a hard time taking my generalist skill set and just stepping right onto a film set with that. And so it wasn't until after I graduated, actually, that I realized that both of these schools really set me up for success in the motion design field, where generalists really have an easier time shining in that field. So at Bournemouth University, I was able to complete my first independent animated short called Hand Wash Line Dry. And we'll actually get into this a little bit later. We're going to dig into some of the character design here. But this short did reasonably well in the rookies. That was a lot of fun. And once I graduated, I was able to kind of bask in this for a little bit. Wrote an article breaking down this short on the rookies blog. So this was a ton of fun and a really neat kind of validating time to realize that I could take all of my independent style choices, my independent character design choices, and just start to finish, animate it, and make something that I was really proud of. So we will screen this in a second. But from here, I launched into the very start of my motion design career. I freelanced for a little bit. And it is worth stating, I think, that back at A&M University, my degree there was an animation degree first and a design degree second. So a lot of my work really depends on the design work that I did back at Texas A&M. So as both a designer and animator, I was able to successfully freelance for a little bit, both designing and animating for a range of clients. Absolutely loved that. And then it was from this short stint in freelancing that I hopped into my first big girl job as a motion designer at Infinite Fiction. They are a lovely post house in Dallas, Texas, and I'm gonna go ahead and screen their reel while I talk about my experience here. But as I stated previously, all of my experience academically and in my short freelance stint had all been Maya-based. And it wasn't until my first job at Infinite Fiction that I actually stepped into Cinema 4D, because that's entirely what this post house works in. And so this team was really great in setting me up with a ton of resources to really get my feet wet in Cinema 4D. And then as a team, we were also able to explore Cinema 4D's character capabilities together, because that was a skill set that I was kind of able to bring to this team. And we were all able to kind of really tear the curtain back off of cinema and find where its strengths lie in character animation. And so we were able to learn together, make a lot of really neat stuff with this team. And you can also find more Infinite Fiction's work at infinitefiction.tv. Definitely check them out, give them a shout. They're a really exceedingly fun team to work for. Had a really, really great time there. And then ended up getting married and moving. And so it was from this move that I ended up going freelance again. So that's where I'm at now. So we'll go ahead and finish out this reel, and then we can go ahead and hop into the rest of the presentation, where my freelance career has taken me, and we can start looking at some character design breakdowns. Alrighty, and with that, let's get this show on the road. This is Tips for Character Animation in C4D and Anywhere Else, a generalist approach to character animation in Cinema 4D. And so what I mean by this is this is a generalist approach. This is my approach to character animation. And so since it is a generalist approach, we are going to cover some foundational tips. And those foundational tips are pretty software agnostic. They can be applied really anywhere as they kind of occur before the animation production part of the pipeline. And then once we get into the actual technical animation, those tips really are going to hone in on the really spectacular tool sets that cinema has for character animation. So without further ado, let's get this thing on the road. And we're going to start with defining your character. And so what I mean by that, when you've got a client that comes to you and they need a character job, or you're trying to tell a character animation story on your own in a shop, whatever, if you're a generalist, you're most likely doing this either with just yourself or a very, very small team, and you don't have a ton of other animators or story artists or character designers to fall back on. And so this is my approach from start to finish of the character animation pipeline as a generalist. And so we'll start at the very, very beginning with defining your character. And so what I mean by that is defining the story that your characters are telling before they've done anything. So when your client pulls up your character designs, they pull up your film, your project, your ad, whatever, before they even push play, what story are your characters telling from the very first frame? And so a principle that I like to fall back on every time is defining your character before you design them. Defining their inner story, defining what their motives are, defining what world they come from, what motivates them in that world, what are they trying to do, and what parts of their character design can tell that story for them before we as animators have even done anything. And so to start, as I mentioned before, we are going to take a look at character design in two projects before we get into the more technical animation part of this talk. And so to start, we're going to look at the character design in my personal project, Hand Wash Line Dry, before we hop into the character design of the Cinnamon Toast Crunch short. So the Cinnamon Toast Crunch short posed a few unique challenges in that we didn't have a massive sandbox to play in when it came to character design, because those characters were pretty predefined, right? They exist in a predefined universe. They are by nature very, very similar characters. So we didn't have just a huge gamut to work with when it came to character design choices. So to really nail in some of these character design principles that I wanted to talk about, we're gonna first take a look at the character design choices in my personal project, Hand Wash Line Dry, and then see how we were able to apply some of those character design choices to the Cinnamon Toast Crunch short. So we're going to go ahead and screen this project first, and let me just lay this out. This project was one of my first projects as a student, so there are definitely things that I would love to change about this project, but from a character design perspective, it does offer some valuable things to pull from. So we're going to go ahead and screen this, and then we'll dive into the character design behind the short. Right, so definitely a blast from the past. Definitely some things about this short that show its age, that show my student skill set at the time. But one of the things that does kind of stand the test of time is the character design in this short. So that's what we're focusing on, and that's what we're going to talk about. So in this short, we have two very opposing characters. We've got Don, this very unamused high-rise tenant, and we've got Dottie, this super excited, super bouncy bird. And so what we're going to talk about here is the character design in these two characters independently and how their character design works together to tell their individual stories and also kind of helps define from a visual standpoint how these characters relate to each other. So we'll go ahead and start off with Don's character design. We'll take a look at how we built this character from the ground up. We knew from the beginning that we wanted Don to be a very, very kind of just kind of regulated, stiff, pretty unamused character. He's pretty boring, and what shape is more boring than a square? And so we used squares and kind of trapezoidal wedges, variations on squares, to build this character from the ground up. And so you can see that square shape even in his hands. He's got these really blocky square nails, he's got these blocky knuckles, these blocky finger shapes, and if we move into his actual body design, this square really permeates all the way through his character design. He's got these really blocky eyebrows, this kind of blocky trapezoidal head shape, and then even like his kneecaps and his feet all hinge on this really blocky trapezoidal rhombus square-based shape. And so if we compare that to Dottie's character, you'll see it's the complete opposite. She's absolutely based on these much rounder, bouncier shapes because she is a very round, bouncy character. And we'll also see in some of her posing sketches here that this circle shape is much more flexible than Don's shape language is. She bounces, she hops, she's always squishing and squashing her way across the set, whereas Don really doesn't express that type of movement. And so we wanted to make sure that Dottie's much more circular shape language helped sell her really bouncy personality through even just the character sketches, and then especially in her animation. And so you'll see here that everything about Dottie is based on circles and ovals, even through her eyes, especially her ovals, which she shares with Don as well, but her eyebrows, whereas Don's were rectangular, hers are absolute little moon shapes. Even her feathers are little moon shapes. So everything about her is much rounder, including her big lovable tummy, than Don is. And if we look at these two characters together in the form of their turnarounds and their model sheets, you'll see that there's a big difference between the shape language here in Don's squares and Dottie's circles. But even though they are opposing characters, they do exist in the same universe. So we're gonna now switch gears and take a look at the similarities between these characters, because even though they are opposing and they have very opposing character traits, we want them to believably live within the same universe and be able to relate to each other. So we're going to shift gears a little bit and take a look at, even though they are so different, what brings them together. And so if you'll look here, even, you know, we did talk about briefly the ovular eye shape that they do share. They also share relative proportions. So if you look at these characters together, you'll see that while in the short, Dottie comes up to about, probably about Don's like hip line here. If you are to make them the same size, their relative proportions are very, very similar. And that's one of the subconscious things that kind of ties them together. And if you'll look one step further at the color palette, you'll see here that they are both based, even though they have very different color proportions, they do still pull from the same color palette. And so we've got this teal, this coral, this goldy beige, and all of these things tie them together, but it's the color proportions that help tell the story. So while Don is a very kind of just like boring, stuffy, high-rise tenant, we made sure that a lot of his color proportions were heavily beige oriented. So he's got a mostly beige little tank top on, his beige little coffee cup, his socks are beige, his skin tone takes up a lot of that beige tone on his body. And then he's got, you know, the whites of his eyes are obviously that color as well. And you really only see pops of color in his hair and his little boxer shorts. Whereas Dottie is the complete opposite. We really only see that beige in the whites of her eyes. Meanwhile, she's this really loud, fussy, bouncy, fun bird. And so we wanted to make sure her whole body really screams that. And what better way to scream fun and bouncy than to be this really, really bright, fierce coral color. And then she's got this opposing teal color in her beak and her eyes and her legs. And she's all the colors that Don uses really only as reserved pops of color. Those are what we used to really define Dottie's character. So in this way, we've been able to tell the story in these characters individually. If you look at them independently, you can kind of guess maybe what a few of their character traits are. And then if you look at them together, you're really able to tell from the get-go what stories they're each telling individually and how they might relate to each other as opposing characters in the animation based on cues like shape, language, body posture, color palettes, color proportions. And from there, we were able to tell the story just based on character design alone as we started to build up the storyboard and the animation. And so now that we've taken a look at some of the broader strokes of character design that we were able to use in this one short, where we were able to build the characters from the ground up, really have a huge say in who these characters were, we're going to take a look at the Cinnamon Toast Crunch short, where we had a much smaller sandbox to play in, but because that sandbox was a bit smaller, it presented some really interesting challenges for us. And so we're going to go ahead and screen the Cinnamon Toast Crunch short, and then from there take a look at how some of these character design principles from this short here still applied to the Cinnamon Toast Crunch short and how we develop those characters within an existing universe. So as you can see in this short, we do have a very similar character dynamic to the one we had in our previous short, where we've got one character who's much more reserved and unamused, juxtaposed against another character who is much more outgoing and causes a whole lot more trouble. So with these characters, we wanted to make sure and differentiate them right off the bat as much as possible, especially given how similar their builds are by default. And so given that we have two square pieces of cereal that both have two eyes and a mouth and 2 feet to work with, we took every step we could to make sure they were as different as possible through our character design phase. And so we named them Curly and Mo. Mo is our much more reserved character. And so we started with him, making him as essentially basic as possible. And so what shape is more basic than a square? We made sure to keep his body language as much of a square at all times, as much as possible. We also made sure to keep him as symmetrical as possible, because when you've got a very symmetrical character juxtaposed against a very irregular character. That was a cue that we wanted to pull on as well. And so we made sure to keep, in these sketches, we were playing with the difference in expression between his eyes being further and further apart, conveying the element of kind of surprise or unamusement with those character cues. But in the final short, what we ended up doing was, in efforts to keep him as symmetrical and therefore as boring as possible, we ended up keeping his eyes at the exact center of his face. His pupils were always exactly centered, the exact same size, and his eyelids were usually also brought down to the halfway point, so his eyes were always half closed to convey this really unamused feeling in this character, as opposed to his counterpart, Curly, where we tried to make sure that his eyes were never quite on the same plane. They were always a slightly different size. His pupils were also a slightly different size, and we tried to stretch that body language as much as possible where we could. So whereas Mo's character was pretty rigid and kind of respected the square boundaries of that body shape, we made sure that Curly's character was always twisting and stretching where he could to convey that kind of zany character trait through his actual body shape. We also had the mouths to work with. These mouths were rigged to where they could slide all across the face. And so with Mo's character, we kept that mouth pretty stationary. It doesn't really move or emote until that final last punchline scene where it gets really, really large. Whereas Curly's character, we were able to slide that mouth all across the face, give it a lot of different amoebic shapes. And then that all leads to the final detail that they shared was the swirl pattern. And so we treated the swirl pattern on these characters kind of as a fingerprint, with each character having their own swirl pattern, their own fingerprint, and trying to convey little personality details through that swirl pattern. And so with Curly's swirl pattern, we made it kind of as zany as possible. We made a lot of really just emotive, expressive swirls, while at the same time trying to make sure we weren't distracting the audience from being able to read his facial expressions. So that was a balance that we had to play with. But that swirl pattern is very different from Mo's, where we tried to keep it a lot more reserved. There's not a lot of these big expressive curls. They're more of these kind of just broad, straighter lines tucked in the corners. And in the final swirl pattern, we ended up giving him almost like a unique combination between like a unibrow and a bad dad haircut was kind of his swirl, to kind of convey both a furrowed brow and just kind of this unamused expression through a subtle swirl pattern across his face. So those were the character traits that we were able to embed in these characters from the get-go, that kind of led us to our final result. So now that we've defined our characters, we know what story they're telling, and we've designed them consciously to tell that story, let's get into the good stuff and start setting some keyframes so we can animate these characters. So what we're going to do next is we're going to hop into Cinema 4D and first take a look at how we use Cinema 4D's tool set to pull off this unique stylized character animation for the Cinnamon Toast Crunch short. So if we look at this scene specifically here, you'll see that we've got this character kind of pancake flopping their way across the stage, right, from left to right. But if we back it up here, you'll see that this character rotates along a different axis point for every rotation. So each 180 flip is happening over a new axis. So ordinarily with a singular character animation rig, you would have a tough time defining a new rotation point like that in space. So we're going to take a look at how Cinema 4D's parent constraint tool helped us pull off this rotation and helped us achieve this consecutive row of 180 flips across the stage. So I've hopped into Cinema, and all I've done here is set up a proxy character, just a cube, chucked a bevel on it to round out those edges to kind of mimic the edges that we see in our Cinnamon Toast Crunch character, and then I've thrown it inside a rectangular spline to act as our character controller. So you can see here, if we select this controller and we move this around, it acts as a proxy controller for our character. So I'm gonna go ahead and collapse this and start taking a look at what it might take to get this character to make several consecutive rotations along different axis points across the stage. So if we take a look at this, it might be tempting as our first move to go ahead and just manually change the axis point of this controller. We can do that by clicking this arrow here, or the shortcut would be to click L, and then to just manually pull this over here, hit L to lock it, and then start rotating that way. And it's tempting, but it's in pretty poor practice. We certainly don't want to be moving the axis point of our character rig around once they've been established. So we'll go ahead and undo, and we'll look at another method. And so if you can't move the rotation point of your actual rig around, it might be tempting to maybe create kind of a third-party object for your object to rotate around. So we've created a null, and we'll go ahead and call it flip one, and we'll move it. We'll go ahead and go into the side view, and we'll move it to the very edge of our character that you want this to rotate around, right? There we go. And it's also worth noting that we've gone ahead and turned snapping on. That's right here. And in doing so, bink, we make sure that this null snaps to the very edge of our character here. So we've created this null, flip one. We'll go ahead and tuck our character underneath here. And you can see that as we rotate flip one, our character goes with it, just as we would expect. So that works for one flip. Let's see if it'll work for two in a row. So we'll undo, let's go ahead and test this. We'll click flip one, go to frame zero, keyframe. Let's go to frame 10, rotate 180 degrees, keyframe again, and it works just as we would expect, right? Let's go ahead and create a second null, and we'll scoot this, bink, right to the edge. It snapped right to the edge of our character. We'll call it flip two. All right, we'll go ahead and freeze transformations here, and then we'll tuck this inside flip two. Okay, so on frame 10, we'll keyframe, and that's where this theory breaks down. So as soon as we keyframed this second null, our whole character popped across the stage, because not only is this character now interpreting, or inheriting, I should say, the position and rotation information of this null, it's also interpreting the position and rotation information of this null. And so it's not able to interpret that information individually. It's now stacking those influences, and we're getting some really unexpected results as those influences start to stack instead of being contributed to our character individually. So let's go ahead and undo everything we just did. All right, one more. There we go. So now we're back at square one. We've got our character here. I'll go ahead and just rename this. We've got our character here, and we've got our null right here. So what we ended up doing in the Cinnamon Toast Crunch short was basically utilizing, similarly to our previous setup, a series of nulls, but they weren't nested. They were all on the same level, and we used Cinema 4D's parent constraints to toggle between them. So let's go ahead and take our character, right click, go down to rigging tags, and set up a constraint. And we'll define it as a parent constraint, and that'll open this window here. And we want to make sure that both position and rotation information is enabled. And then we'll go down here and we'll define flip one as our target. And so flip one has already been placed at the edge of our character, and we'll see here that as the parent, it controls our character just as we would expect. So let's hop back over to frame zero, and let's keyframe flip one here. Let's go down 10 frames, rotate 180 degrees, keyframe again. And this is something that we can get into. We're not going to get into too much detail right now, but you will see, you know, as this character rotates around the outermost edge, you do get this gap space right here in this rotation. And we mitigated that basically by brute force, by, you know, going halfway down through our rotation, compensating, essentially counter animating, right? So now we get a more even roll. So we won't do that for every flip for the sake of this demo, but that is how we mitigated that little gap in our final animation. So we've got a 10 frame rotation here, and now we need a new null to take up this edge right here. So we'll go up here, we'll create a null. We'll name him flip two, and we will slide him right over to the edge, and it snaps right to the outer corner of our character. And now, here's where the parent constraint comes in handy. So we've currently got one target here, and what we're gonna do is add another target and define it as flip two. But you'll see once we add targets, we now have the option to animate the weight of each target. And what that basically means is we're animating the influence that each null has over our character. And so we've defined these rotations as 10 frame rotations. So if we focus on flip one by itself right here, we'll see that the weight, flip There we go. Flip one. We'll see that the weight of this parent constraint needs to remain at 100% all the way through these 10 frames of rotation. And once we get to frame 11, we're done with the flip one null. So at frame 10, let's keyframe the weight at 100. And frame 11, we can turn it all the way to zero because we're done with flip one. And now that we don't have any more influence from this null, we can go ahead and define our second target as flip two. So now that we're on frame 11, we'll go ahead and key this weight all the way to 100, and we're gonna back it up to frame 10 and remove all of the influence. Because what we don't want is any competing influence from multiple nulls at once. That'll yield some pretty unexpected results. So we wanna make sure that we have all of our weights keyframed on and off on the frames here and here, making sure that we don't have any competing influences. So now that we're on frame 11 and all the influence belongs to flip two, let's go ahead and animate this null here. So we'll keyframe it, we'll rotate 180 degrees. Oops, that's not true. We'll go down 20 frames, down to the 20th frame. Okay. We'll slide down to the 20th frame, rotate 180 degrees, and keyframe again. And now, if we scrub through what we have so far, we've got two rotations in a row. Our previous demo, it fell apart once we started this second rotation, and now this parent constraint system allows us to pick up one null and leave off another to keep rotating. And so, to make this work all the way across the stage, we would essentially just repeat the process, set up a third null, go down to our parent constraint. We'd make sure that on frame 20, we have all the weight on flip two, and on frame 21, remove all weight, keyframe, and now that we've keyframed this to zero, we are free to add a new target, define it as flip three, and just keep moving. And so you'll see with this method, it's essentially exactly what we did in our Cinnamon Toast Crunch scene. So here, we pull this up, and you can see we've got our character flip-flopping through the scene, right? But if you look, you'll see that inside this toast rig, go all the way down here, this is our parent constraint tag. And if you look in this window, you'll see we've got the same system set up. We've got this character relying on this system of nulls, accepting influence from one, and then another, and then the next one, and then the next one. It's the same exact setup, the same series of nulls, and this is how we were able to pull off this scene, was through relying on Cinema 4D's parent constraint system. And what we did here, we didn't exactly do this in the demo, we did in this scene add some secondary animation elements. So if we play through here, you'll see that in between each null, we added some secondary animation like character bounce and settle, feet bounce and settle, and all those secondary animation elements that make it a little more fun to watch. And that was all possible once we established this initial null system, this 1 through 7 null system. So that's how we pulled off this scene, and we did it with Cinema 4D's parent constraint. All right, so far we've taken a look at pulling off some of the body animation of these characters, but next we're gonna take a look at what is arguably the most expressive parts of these characters, which are their crazy tongues and mouths. So we're gonna take a look at some of the tool sets that Cinema 4D has that enable us to come up with some creative solutions to modeling, rigging, animating, and even compositing some of the crazy components of these characters. So first things first, we'll take a look at how we built out the mouths on these characters. And we did that through animating and extruding spline shapes. So in order to build out the spline, we're gonna wanna hop into our front view to make sure all of our spline points are lying on the same plane. We'll grab our pen tool, and here we're just gonna rough out a really basic, quick and dirty version of that final mouth shape that we see kind of at the punchline of the Cinnamon Toast Crunch short, where his mouth opens real big as he munches down and eats that other character. So we closed our spline here, and now we're just gonna go through, double click on each spline point to access our spline handles. There we go. And from there we get this really soft shape, and right off the bat it's pretty evident how limitless these shapes are. If we, between the number of spline points we have and the length of our spline handles, we've got a ton of freedom as far as the types of shapes that we make here. And so you can see we've just got all these possibilities, all these really fun anemic, or excuse me, all these really fun amoebic shapes that add a lot of expressiveness to our character that might be a little more difficult to do in more traditional character rigging methods. So if we hop out to our front view, you'll see all it is just a one-dimensional spline. And so what we did to fill that in was popped it into an extrude. And so we just tucked it in here, and right off the bat, you can see how that fills in that shape. And we just pulled this down, and we'll get into the why the depth parameter of this matters in the later part of our demo, but popping it into extrude was the way that we filled out this shape for our short. So we'll hop down here, we'll turn off our extrude to clean up that line a little bit, and now let's get into how we animated this spline shape. So for the sake of this demo, we're just gonna do a really quick squash and stretch. And so let's grab this spline point here, this one here, we're at frame zero, we'll keyframe. Let's go down, let's say frame 20, and let's squish it down and make this real, real wide. Whoop. Okay. And then we'll grab these and we'll maybe rotate them around, pull it in a little. So, I didn't say it was a pretty shape, but it's a squishy shape. And we'll keyframe. And so here we've got just this point-to-point squash. Super quick and dirty, but it's a squash, right? And so this is where we bring up one of our first points, is that all we've done is grab this point and this one. We have not animated any of these four points down here, but what you'll see is that if we grab these two, let's scoot them out here a little bit, and keyframe. Since we haven't keyframed them previously, you would expect them to remain in this location for the duration of this animation here. But what you'll see is on the next keyframe 20, they snap right back. And that's because with point level animation, the second you keyframe the location of one spline point, you've effectively keyframed the location of all the spline points along the spline. And so the significance of that being that it's super important as you go about your animation to block out your poses of your entire spline shape as you go along. So it's really key to make sure that you've got all your spline points in an appealing position at each main pose as you do your animation blocking. So I'm gonna go ahead and delete this keyframe. So we're back to our simple little beanbag squash here. But as you can see here, it's a pretty basic squish. There's not much to it. And what any animator's gonna wanna do is put some ease on this shape here, on this squish. So let's go ahead and open our Animate panel and go to our graph editor. And you'll see down here on our point level animation, we're expecting maybe to find some beautiful Bezier curves down here, and we really just don't see a lot of anything. And as an animator, it's easy to get frazzled when your graph editor is empty, because how are you supposed to smooth all your curves when there are no curves to smooth? So here, Cinema does have a little trick up its sleeve. What we can do is right click on our spline, add a special track, and give it a time track. And this acts very similarly to the speed graph in After Effects. And so what we'll do is we'll grab this and we'll just pull it over to frame 20 to align with the duration of our animation here. And we'll give it a spline handle and we'll just drag this out. So we've got it dragged out in a way that gives us a quick start here and then kind of a long, slow ease on the end. And so what we'll need to do next is grab our point level animation parameter. It'll ask for a time track. We've got plenty of parameters down here, so that's why we need to make sure and assign the time track to the correct parameter. We'll grab our target here and we'll assign it to this brand new time track. And so now, if we play through our animation, what used to be just a plain pose-to-pose animation, point A to point B, now has that ease as defined by this time curve here. And so this curve is completely editable. We can always go back and change it. Super, super flexible. We can, you know, invert the shape that we gave it the first time, add ease on both sides. It works the exact same as any other curve would in Cinema 4D. So you'll see you play through it. It now eases on both the front and the back. So what that'll do is just gives you a little more flexibility in how your point level animation curves move. And it also gives you a bit more control as an animator to get those eases on those curves that we're so familiar with and that we so often rely on. And in the Cinnamon Toast Crunch short, we did do a lot of this animation by hand, pose to pose, but having this extra level of control really helped us finesse our shapes and give us that animation control that we were looking for. So there are certainly some tricky bits to animating splines in Cinema 4D, but it's also certainly worth the payoff when you consider just how flexible these shapes are. They're also infinitely scalable, and they're also smooth Bezier shapes, which is super nice when you need these really bendy rubber band shaped mouth shapes for these characters. So with the spline tool in Cinema 4D, we were able to get the really expressive character facial expressions that we needed. So we've talked a little bit about the construction of this mouth here, but let's take a look at our actual rig file and pick apart how we got it to affix to the surface of the body. So this here is our rig file, and you can see here we've got some test animation done on it to make sure that this rig can hold up to anything we need it to do squash and stretch wise. But let's take a look at this mouth here, and you can see it's the same setup. It's a spline here that's been extruded, and what we've done is taken that extrusion and we've just clamped it to the surface of the body. So this is nothing but a clamp constraint. And in doing this, it enabled us to constrain the spline mouth shape to the surface of the body, but it didn't restrict us to just a singular point along the surface of the body. So you can see here, if we grab the spline, we're able to scoot it all along the surface of the body, and we're not constrained to one location. We can rotate it, scale it, so we don't have any restrictions here, and it really enables us to get that cartoony animation style we needed in being able to slide this mouth all across the surface of the face. And you'll see here that as we move it around, the tongue follows as well, which was super important. We'll get into that in a second. But one of the things we had hinted at earlier was the reason that this extrusion depth was important. And so here, you'll see it's pretty thin, there's really nothing to it, and what's worth noting here is that we ended up rendering in passes. And so we'd render a Cinnamon Toast Crunch pass, and then we would render a mouth pass, and we would end up compositing those together. And the reason this depth here was important was because at render time, we were not interested in having any actual depth here. We didn't want any 3D shadows from this mouth plane to be cast onto the body. All we wanted was this 2D cartoony shape that we could then art direct the shadows for in post. And so in doing that, we were able to keep this extrusion depth really, really thin for render time, and then bump it up to something thicker so that we could easily animate with it in 3D without having it clip through the body, and then push it back down to something really trim for render time. And so that's how we accomplished that. But let's take a look at this tongue here. And so, you know, we saw earlier if we moved this mouse spline around, the tongue followed, and we pulled that off by another constraint. So let's look down here, and you'll see that this tongue geo is simply the tongue wrapped around a spline wrap, right? And we took this whole system here and we constrained it to what, you know, we call this tongue constraint mount. And all that is a really super, super tiny hidden piece of geometry that gives us a singular point along this extruded surface to mount the tongue to. That constraint mount has been constrained to the mouth spline fill here, and that's how all of these are connected. And so let's take a look at this spline wrap. All it is, if we disable this, we'll see that this is our tongue geometry, right? Just this big paddle shape. And it's just been chucked in a spline wrap around this spline here with our spline handles. And we got these through a plugin, actually. This is a Python script by Curious Animals that's been pulled up here. It's available at this link up here. It's a free Python script. Definitely recommend it. It made this super, super easy breezy. And in launching this Python script here, it basically gave us a controllable animatable spline. So we set up nulls along a spline, and then that Python script gave us these handles that we could animate, pull, push, do all kind of stuff with. And so between those spline handles and the spline wrap, we were able to get these really, really bendy, cartoony shapes within this tongue rig. And the spline wrap also gave us the freedom to really squash and stretch this area of the tongue, which was really crucial as well. So if we hop into the size parameter of our spline wrap, you'll see here that pulling this down really pinches and pulls that area of the tongue to really convey that sense of stretchiness in this spline wrap. So that was a nice parameter to have to work with as well. And so with this spline rig plugin, we were able to make the spline not only for the actual tongue itself, but the corresponding spline rail. And so we just duplicated this spline here, popped it up, made a spline rail out of it. And in doing that, we were able to control the banking of this tongue as well. So here's our actual spline wrap down here. And then if we take the corresponding spline rail null, you'll see that we're able to bank this tongue any which way to make sure that it's always looking at camera. We've always got an appealing angle while we animate to camera. And so that's how we pulled off the rig and animation of this tongue. And then next we're gonna get into a little bit of the compositing that we used to make sure that this tongue actually looked like it was tucking into this mouth cavity as opposed to just butting into this hard geometry here. So next we'll take a look at some of the compositing tricks that we use in our Cinnamon Toast Crunch short. So we've hopped into compositing here, and here you can see we've got our base composite. We've got a few layers of composite stripped back for the sake of this demo here, but you can see that we've got our Cinnamon Toast Crunch character, this crazy tongue, and then zero shadow compositing. And so what I'm gonna walk through here is how we pulled off this shadow composite in post, since we weren't able to achieve any natural shadows in 3D. And this was a super easy approach, a super old fashioned approach. You can see the outline here. It's really just a shape layer. It's just a shape layer filled with black and then Gaussian blurred to taste to create the illusion of the tongue pushing back into this mouth cavity that in reality is just a flat piece of black geometry. And so all I'm doing here is just demonstrating how simple it is to set up your own shape layer. These were all hand drawn to fit within the extruded mouth splines of each character, and then they were just Gaussian blurred to taste. And so these shape layers were all animated either by hand or via tracking the intersection of the back of that bright pink tongue against the black geometry. And so it was completely shot dependent. Some of these shape layers were tracked, some were animated by hand depending on what the shot had to offer and how easy it was. In shots like this where there's just not a ton of movement here, it was much easier to do by hand, especially with this character intersection where this character comes flying in from screen left to intersect this shadow. And so here we've just Gaussian blurred this shape layer to taste. We're gonna pop it back onto the tongue, and that's really it. That was our little secret to compositing these super crazy tongues into the mouth cavities and making them feel like they actually took up some 3D space and offered some natural shadow that still gave us the stylized feel we were looking for. All right, so for our last demo, with the time we have left, we're gonna take a look at how we pulled off some of the character effects in this shot. And so odds are, if you're a generalist working on a character-based spot, you're gonna have to tackle some of the character effects as well. And so we're gonna take a look at how the easy breezy matte selection in Cinema 4D helped us come up with the solution for this tongue dragging across the camera lens in this shot here. So we've hopped into Cinema into a stripped down version of this scene, and you can see here you've got this character dragging this big cartoon tongue across the camera lens. But let's hop into our perspective view and see what's actually happening here. So we'll hop over here and we'll see the second we hop into perspective view, all of our secrets are out. We've got this tongue geometry pushing straight through the body. We've got all kinds of mess going on back here. But that's the beauty of animating to camera, is that these are all our little secrets here. And so you can see that in order to exaggerate this tongue shape and size, we've got it really pushed up against this character. And we've essentially just kind of faked this camera plane here. There's, as you can see, this tongue really isn't pressing up against anything. And to really get that feeling of this squishy, soft body tongue pressing up against glass, we wanted to achieve that in post. And so in order to do that, we needed to find a way to get a selection. We wanted to find a way to get this reliable and repeatable selection of this tongue's soft body squishing up against a glass plane. And so the way we did that was essentially faking a camera lens plane. And so you can see up here, we've got this tongue plane turned off, but if we turn it on, you'll see it's essentially just a big plane intersecting with our tongue here. So let's hop back into our actual camera view, and you'll see what we get here is this really squishy tongue shape pushing up against this plane. And so the reason we needed this was because we wanted to be able to select this kind of heart-shaped tongue pressing up against the glass, and we wanted to not have to outline that shape by hand. If we rendered our shot and then we got all of our character effects done based on a shape we had drawn by hand and then decided later we needed to move our character or reanimate our shot, all of our character effects would be blown. We'd have to start from scratch. We wanted this selection shape to be based on a mat that we could then just refresh in composite and then keep our effect alive. And so you'll see up here that all we did was render out a beauty pass with this turned off, and then we went back and rendered another pass with an AOV. And we just took this here, set up a tongue plane AOV through Arnold, which, you know, obviously you can do this any which way. It'd be super, super easy through CryptoMat, whatever your method would be. And then we took this AOV and we were able to grab basically just a matte shape of this little heart-shaped blob that we could use in composite. So let's hop into composite and see what we were able to do with that shape. Here's our tongue render, and let's go through and let's turn off some of these effects that gave us that final result. So here's that tongue render given to us just by that mat that we spit out. And if we hop in here, that's what we would expect. That's the mat we were given. And so from here, we were able to take this tongue mat, super easily selectable via CryptoMat or AOV, whatever your method. And then we went in and we wanted a really, really cartoony, stylized kind of spit drag effect. And so to achieve that, we made some hand-drawn spline shapes here and here, and we just hand animated these to kind of expand as that tongue drags across the scene. So these are all just hand animated soft blob shapes, but we did want them to move reliably and again repeatedly with that tongue shape. So what we have up here is a tracking null. So if you look back at our shot, this tongue has all this really fun, bright texture on it. And so what this means is that each of these little points is totally trackable, which really worked in our benefit. And so we're able to take a tracking null right here, affix it to any one of these points, say this one in particular. And if you hop down here, you'll see all of these tracking points in which we were able to track that tongue and assign that tracking information to these little blobs right here. And so between those blobs, this reliable little shape in which we were able to affix some color correction, we were able to go from here to here, which was our final desired result, made possible through the After Effects Blobalize filter, and then being able to track and reliably color correct that one steady part of the tongue made possible by that matte selection that was so easy breezy in Cinema 4D. All right, so that concludes our demos for the day. I hope you've enjoyed them. Real quick, let's do a breakdown of what we've covered. What did we talk about? We talked about defining our characters, making sure we know what their story is, what story they're trying to tell, and making sure that that story motivates every decision we make about these characters, making sure that inner story defines the way we design, the way we build our characters, the color palette that we choose, the color proportions we choose, the shape language that we use, and then making sure that we take that inner story and we let it define all the animation choices that we make in Cinema 4D. And so then we pull the curtain back on Cinema 4D to take a look at how parent constraints, spline animations, spline wraps, matte selection, and then a few compositing tricks helped tell the story that we set out to tell. And so to wrap that up, everything you do can have a little bit of character. Put a little pizzazz in it. You don't have to let character animations stop at traditionally defined characters. Just because your model doesn't have two eyes and a mouth doesn't mean it can't express a story or a vibe or a feeling. So let that inner story define all the decisions that you make in your work, and there's no limit to the stories that you can tell in Cinema 4D. So with that, my name is Alex Parker. Thank you so much. All of my work can be found at alexparkerdesign.com. I'm also available at all of these social profiles under the handle Alex Parker Design. If you're on Slack, you can find me active on both the Grayscale Gorilla Slack and the mograph.com Slack as well. So if you have any questions, don't hesitate to hit me up on any of these profiles, and I would be more than happy to chat. And so with that, thank you so much for watching. Thank you to Maxon. Thank you to Matthias. Thank you all for sticking around. It's been a blast. Thank you so much.